with power, with creativity, and let it fly. Let it fly high to reach the sky. Let your passion lead you. Take you places. Script your success story. And make you a champion in your mastery. Transform your dreams into reality with Ramapuram SRM Institute of Science and Technology.
நண்பா, உனக்கு ஞாபகம் இருக்கா?
வணக்கம். இன்றைய முக்கிய செய்திகள். கொரோனா முடக்கம் அறிவிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. இதனால் அனைத்து கல்லூரிகளும் அடைக்கப்பட்டு ஆன்லைனில் வகுப்புகள் நடைபெறும் என்பது இதன் மூலமாக அறிவிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது.
அப்போ ஹேஷ்டாக்
Proceed. Can we start?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. Good architecture talks about its time and place, but yearns for timelessness. I welcome you all to this spectacular event from the comfort of your home. SRM Seed is proud to host the fourth edition of Hashtag, which is also the second virtual hashtag. We are truly delighted to welcome you all to Hashtag 2021, Unlocked Loop of Respite. We'd like to thank Madan's Makeover, a tailor-made salon, for being our sponsors for today's session. I, Roselette, and Sublakshmi, students of School of Environment, Architecture and Design, SRM Ramapuram, are your moderators for today's session. Before we dive in, keeping in mind about the webinar being a virtual approach, I request everyone to keep your microphones on mute and kindly turn off your videos throughout the session. I request everyone to not interrupt the speaker during the session. The question and answer session will be held towards the end, where the participants can post their questions in the chat box. SRM Seed is honored to have the Honorable Dr. Ganapathy Mahalingam, sir, as our guest speaker for today's session to talk to us about the topic, Towards a Philosophy for the Architecture of India. Welcome, sir. I now request VP Admin Professor NSA Venkatesh Babu, sir, to welcome our guest.
Roselette? Please. You please invite Architect Professor NSA Ravi, sir, our design chair, to give the welcome address.
Okay. I now request our VP Admin Professor NSA Ravi, sir, to welcome our guest.
Good morning, one and all. it's a great pleasure to be here with you all to attend Dr. Ganapathy's speech. I am very thankful to our chairman, co-chairman, and the management, all the deans and senior professors, and our colleagues, and mainly the students who's been the backbone behind the entire organization. Really, hats off to them. This is our fourth edition, making us proud, with the kind of show we give. This is the second virtual, and it's all been carried out so beautifully well by the students, and they are kind of the heroes behind the show. I'm honored to welcome Dr. Ganapathy Mahalingam for the speech, and I've known him in the past about 42 years, and he's very versatile and brilliant. I've known him from school days for his mettle with architectural design and other subjects. And no wonder, he is holding such a high position in one of the most revered universities. And I'm very happy and pleased to welcome Dr. Ganapathy Mahalingam. Welcome, Ganapathy.
Thank you.
That was a very warm welcome, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Let me take the privilege of introducing our guest speaker now, Architect Ganapathy Mahalingam, sir. He is a well-established researcher in the field of computer-aided architectural design. His research focuses on using computer technology for the process of architectural design. Professor Mahalingam holds a PhD in architecture, which he earned at the University of Florida in 1995. For his doctoral dissertation, Dr. Mahalingam developed a computer-based design system for the design of proscenium-type auditoriums. Dr. Mahalingam served as the president of the Association of Computer-Aided Design of Architecture, also known as ACADIA. The ACADIA is a premier organization in the United States for educators, researchers, and practitioners in the field of computer-aided design and architecture. In 2009, Dr. Mahalingam founded the Design Digital Solutions LLC, a software company in the state of North Dakota for creating software products for design professions. He teaches the Design Thesis Studio, the Advanced Architectural Design Studio, a lecture course on thesis research, and a seminar on the architecture of India. Now, without further ado, we will start the session. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. And I suppose people are joining us from all over the world. So whatever time it is in the day for you, good day to you. Good morning to everyone in India. First of all, I thank you for this opportunity. Thank the School of Environment, Architecture and Design of the SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Ramapuram campus. And my good friend, architecture professor, NSA Ravi, whom I've known for over four decades, for inviting me to come and present what is close and dear to my heart, which is the creation of indigenous philosophy for the architecture of India. I hope I'll provide you a thought-provoking set of insights, hopefully we can have a good discussion at the end of the presentation. Once again, thank you for this opportunity, I'm really honored and thankful that I'm able to reach out and talk to you across the globe. So with that, I'm going to get started with my presentation. Are you able to see the first slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The title of my presentation this morning is Towards a Philosophy for the Architecture of India. And I say it's towards a philosophy because we do not have one yet in the contemporary realm of education and practice. So this presentation sets the path that leads us towards a philosophy for the architecture of India. And that's what I hope to accomplish with this presentation this morning. Okay. I want to begin by talking about why I'm interested in the development of an indigenous philosophy for the architecture of India. I grew up, I was born in Chennai, and I grew up in Chennai during my youth. I attended the Don Bosco Matriculation School in Egmore, Chennai. And then I studied architecture at the School of Architecture and Planning, SAP, now part of Anna University. Then it was part of the University of Madras. And those were my formative years in architecture. And something very significant happened during my educational experience at the School of Architecture and Planning. In the second year of the curriculum of the Bachelor of Architecture degree program, we were asked to abandon all the things we had learned in our first year, which was based on the Bauhaus mode of design education, featuring basic design and design composition and things like that. And we were taken to a village on the outskirts of Chennai, a village called Thirunirmalai. And we were asked to study the village, study its people, study its way of life, mm-hmm. study its architecture, study its context, study everything about it. Because in the curriculum, it was important for us to come in touch with the way people, majority of the people in India lived. And it was very important for us to understand that. And at that time, I did not know it, but some seeds were planted that have stayed with me, and they have nurtured a small growing tree, which is what this presentation is a part of, the tree that hopes to grow into a philosophy for the architecture of India. So that's the thing that I have nurtured in my heart. And I went to the United States in 1985 to get a Master of Architecture degree at Iowa State University. And then I came back to India, practiced for a little bit, and then came back again to the United States to do my PhD at the University of Florida in 1989. And then before I could finish my PhD, I got a job at North Dakota State University in 1993. And I finished my PhD in 94 and got my degree in 95. And since 1993, for the past 28 years, I've been teaching at North Dakota State University in what was then the Department of Architecture and Landscape Architecture, and now it's the Department of Architecture alone. And in those 28 years, for over 20 years, I've been teaching a seminar on the architecture of India. So I never let this seed that was planted in me in that second year of the curriculum at the School of Architecture and Planning, I never let it die. Yeah, that tree has been growing. And in the past 28 years, at least 20 of them have been devoted to studying the architecture of India in some form or the other, teaching my students at North Dakota State University about a non-Western tradition. Of course, it was my tradition, but for them, it was a non-Western tradition. And as I was teaching them the architecture of India, and we got to discuss the philosophy of the architecture of India, and I had to introduce them to Vastu Shastra and texts like the Mayamatam, as you may call it in South India. And I had to engage my students in explain to them on what basis all of these things are founded and how they were practiced in ancient India and what has happened to them now in contemporary practice. So this has been a, ongoing discussion with my students over the years. And it has been a very revealing process, trying to explain to them and thereby understanding a lot of it myself. So that is what this presentation is about, how to get in touch with a philosophy for the architecture of India. So I'm going to move on with my first slide. You might ask, what has philosophy got to do with architecture? And I would just counter that with the question, is it not all philosophy? Because the tradition of architecture from India is called the Vastu Shastra, which are the treatises on being or existence as dwelling. So very early on, the people in ancient India realized that architecture is about dwelling. And that's the focus of architecture, and architecture is a means to dwell. And they also, in mainstream philosophy of India, especially in Advaita Vedanta, they said Brahman is the only Vastu. There's only one Vastu, and that's Brahman. So if you're studying Vastu Shastra, you should be studying Brahman, because in the final analysis, Brahman is the only thing that dwells. So is it not all philosophy? You can counter and ask that question. So if someone asks you, how is philosophy related to architecture? At the core, is it not all philosophy? So how does this Vastu come to be? And there is a well-understood hierarchy if you study the philosophy of India and how it understands the world around us. There is a hierarchy from the highest principle down to the Vastu. The Vastu Shastra deals with Vastu. And there are many kinds of Vastu, and we'll see that in just a little bit further down in the presentation. So you start with the highest principle, chit, or consciousness, pure consciousness. And then this pure consciousness is not content to be passive as something that is just aware. And it encounters shunya, or the void, and also sometimes depicted as the potent void, as the bindu. And then it tries to manifest itself. And then from that emerges prana, or life, and from that chitta, which is the mind, which is a reflection of consciousness. And then deha, the body. And then finally vastu, that the Vastu Shastra deals with. So from the highest principle of pure consciousness, there's a evolutionary process that slowly leads to Vastu as we know it as architects and designers. So how do we start formulating this philosophy for the architecture of India? My suggestion is that we start with the fundamental principles of existence and then see how it can form the foundation or the basis for the philosophy for an architecture of India. So this is one approach that will put us on the path towards this philosophy. So in Shaivism, the followers of the deity Shiva, they identify 36 principles, fundamental principles or tattvas, as a way to describe the organization and structure of the universe as we know it. So there are 5 pure tattvas, and then there are 7 pure impure tattvas, or a mixture of pure and impure, and then there are 24 impure tattvas. Now, all these tattvas or fundamental principles start to impact the creation of vastu. And that's why they can be the basis for philosophy for the architecture of India. So they can be used for to create a philosophy for the architecture of India. And we'll, as we go through the presentation, we'll see how we can relate these fundamental principles or tattvas to architecture as we know it now, both in the educational realm as well as the practitioner realm. So the first set of tattvas, the pure tattvas, are at the highest level. On the top are Shiva and Shakti. And many of you know Shiva and Shakti should be common cultural knowledge. Shiva and Shakti are at the top of these tattvas. And then you have three tattvas that form the pure tattvas, the Sadashiva tattva, the Ishvara tattva, and the Shuddha Vidya tattva. Now, later on, I'm going to explain how these impact or inform a philosophy of architecture. We're just going through the tattvas now as a structure, and then I'm going to get into each one of them, and we're going to talk about how they form the basis for architecture. So those are the pure tattvas. These are the pure impure tattvas. So you have the Maya tattva, and then you have the Kala tattva, Kala tattva, Niyati tattva, Vidya tattva, and Raga tattva. These are the pure impure, the mixed tattvas. And we'll see how those impact our philosophy of architecture. And then we have the impure tattvas. You see one tattva there, the Purusha tattva in the violet color. That's because it belongs to the previous category. And then you have all the other impure tattvas. You have Prakriti tattva, you have the Buddhi, Manas, and Ahamkara tattvas. Then you have the Jnanendriyas, the indriyas of knowledge. And then we have the karmendriyas, the indriyas or engines of karma or action. Then we have the tanmatras, the modes of perception. And then you have the mahabhutas, the principal elements in the universe. So we take the structure of 36 tattvas that are identified in Shaivism. And if you take branches of Shaivism, like Shaiva Siddhanta in South India, it expands to 96 tattvas. They add a lot more to that. So this is the basic set of tattvas in Shaivism. So if you take this as a basis and you look at the pure tattvas first, that is the Shiva tattva, the Shakti tattva, Sadashiva tattva, Ishvara tattva, and Shuddha Vidya tattva. Look at the first two. The Shiva tattva is pure consciousness. This is the highest principle in the universe. Pure consciousness is just aware. It's aware of everything. And it just doesn't remain aware. It comes in contact with Shakti, and then it realizes it can manifest itself. So with Shiva and Shakti, the universe is both perceived and manifested when these two work together. So that's the fundamental basis of creating vastu. First, you need to be conscious that there's something out there that you can build in, and then you should have the energy, the power to manifest what it is that you want to create. So this consciousness of possibility and the power and energy to manifest, the very seed of architecture. First, you need to know that you are aware that you can create. And then you need to realize you have the power to create. So first step in architecture is the awareness that you can create. And the second step is discovering that you have the power to create. So that's Shiva and Shakti. The awareness that you can create is Shiva. The power that you can create, realizing that, is Shakti. And that's at the highest principle. So all our works of architecture should start at this point. The awareness that you can create, which without that, no architecture can begin, and realizing that you have the power to create. So you have the aspects of Shiva and Shakti at the very beginning of architecture. This is an interesting quote from the architect Louis Kahn. In the previous slide, it says Shiva is consciousness and light, prakasha, and Shakti is awareness of the light. So if you look at this quote from Louis Kahn, the architect, and it's interesting that the two Western master architects who practiced in India, Louis Kahn and Le Corbusier, both had great affinities for the philosophy behind the architecture of India. This is a quote from Louis Kahn. He said, "We are born of light," means we are born of Shiva. "The seasons are felt through light. We only know the world as it is evoked by light. And from this comes the thought that material is spent light, that is, it's used up light." So Shiva, the light manifesting in the material universe. Now, what Louis Kahn is talking about is material is spent light. So the light of Shiva, when it's spent or used up, it manifests itself as material. So here we see a Western architect who came to practice in India and came in contact with the yogic tradition. And the architect Balakrishna Doshi used to call him a yogi, Louis Kahn. And he had this profound insight that relates to Shiva as light and when Shiva manifests, the light is spent and it becomes material. It's a very interesting connection between a Western master architect who comes in contact with Indian yogic traditions and then puts out this quote. Then moving on in the pure tattvas, you have the Sadashiva tattva where you see the universe in yourself. This is a common experience of awareness. We look out and we see the world. We look at the night sky, we see the stars. The whole world and the universe appears to be in our minds. So this notion that the universe is in us, that comes from a notion of subjectivity, the aham, that is the Sadashiva Tattva. So you need to somehow, to be an architect, have a sense that you have access to the entire universe. We assume we have access to the site. We assume we have access to materials. We assume we have access to technology. We assume so many things that we have access to. So having access to the universe is one of these beginning points in architecture. Now the next tattva, the Ishvara tattva, is the realm of objectivity. So I am in the universe, or I am part of the universe, the idam. So here you are an operator in the architecture of the universe. You are in the universe. and you are a part of the universe. And in the Shuddha Vidya Tattva, the third one, these two balance. You have access to the universe, you are part of the universe, hence you can do architecture. So this is a fundamental understanding which we take for granted and don't realize when we practice architecture, that we have access to the universe and we are part of the universe at the same time. And we act when we balance these two things together to create a work of architecture. So then we move on to the pure and impure tattvas. This is the Maya tattva. Maya is that force in the universe that creates limits for us. And there are these five veils of Maya, the kanchukas, and these veils limit what we can do in architecture. And they are the Kala Tattva, the Kala Tattva, the Niyati Tattva, the Raga Tattva, and the Vidya Tattva. So what are these limits that we face in architecture? So if you look at these kanchukas in the pure and impure tattvas, the limitation of time, how many times have we thought, oh, I need another year to finish this construction project, or I'm not able to do this part of this building because I don't have time. So the limitation of time, Kala. Kala is time, and it always limits what you can become or what you can do. Then the limitation of agency. This is where you think technology, abilities, Kala. Kala is the whole world of arts. Arts includes technology. So all the arts, the fine arts, the technological arts, the computational arts, everything is Kala. Kala is the limit of agency, your ability to do things. And then Raga is the limitation of desire. What you desire limits you. You want to do a particular thing that limits you in architecture. And then there's the limitation of circumstance. You have a particular site, you have a particular building code, you have a particular traffic pattern. Everything is niyati, circumstance, the limitation of circumstance. Destiny is another word they use for niyati. And then there's the limitation of knowledge. Your knowledge limits the architecture that you can create. And that's the Maya's veil of vidya. So these five veils are kanchakas of Maya: Kala, Kala, Raga, Niyati, and Vidya. They limit the architecture that you can do. So if you move on to the impure tattvas, you have Prakriti, which is the energy. And of course, energy limits the architecture that you can create. And then you have the buddhi, manas, and ahamkara tattvas. And then you have the jnanendriyas, karmendriyas, tanmatras, and mahabhutas. So how we create vastu? We use our buddhi, which is our logic, our reasoning, our intellect. We use our manas, our feelings, our emotions. And we use our ego, our ahamkara. Because without ego, you cannot create your own concept, your own design, anything that has a personal creative impetus or creative basis. So you need ahamkara for that. So you create vastu using all these three tattvas. Then the mahabhutas, earth, prithvi, that's all the materials, all your building materials are part of the earth. So that is prithvi. Then there's water. Water you use both in the building and also you have to deal with water in terms of rain and snow and moisture. And fire is basically your heat. Your heat gain in summer, your heat loss in winter. So fire in the form of heat and air, ventilation. and ether. Now, ether is very important in buildings too, because that's how all your wireless systems communicate. But ether is an ancient word. They don't use ether anymore. It represents the radiation spectrum, which includes electromagnetic radiation in the form of light, and then radio waves, cellular waves, all of those. So we can replace the ancient notion of ether with the radiation spectrum. So those are the Mahabhutas. The Karmendriyas, what does Vastu enable us to do? Enables us to use our legs, our hands, our mouths when we talk about the Vastu, and also our excretory organs. And then the Gyanendriyas, how we perceive Vastu through our senses, using our nose, our tongue. Hopefully we don't keep trying to taste our buildings, even though if you make a gingerbread house, you can eat it. And then your eye, your skin, your ear. This is how we perceive and access and understand and enjoy Vastu. So those are the Gyanendriyas. So this is another quote from the other master Western architect, Le Corbusier, who practiced in India. He said, in the final analysis, architecture is the eyes that see, the head that turns, and the leg that walks. So he was talking about Gyanendriyas and Karmendriyas as being architecture. So here we have a Western master architect who came in touch with India and her philosophy. And this is what he comes up with as a quote. Architecture is the eyes that see, the head that turns, and the leg that walks. So what does a philosophical framework provide? It provides the following classical branches: metaphysics, epistemology, logic, aesthetics, and ethics. These are the classical branches of philosophy. Metaphysics helps us answer questions like, what is the true nature of existence? Epistemology answers, how do we know what we know? Logic provides us methods to go from premises to conclusions. Aesthetics helps us answer what makes something beautiful. And ethics tells us whether something is right to do or not. So if you're going to create a philosophy for the architecture of India, you have to address these branches and these realms. And let's see what India has already done in these realms in its classical culture. So these are the methods to acquire knowledge. This is the portion known as epistemology. And according to the darshanas, the schools of philosophy in India, there are six pramanas, or methods of gaining knowledge, which is directly epistemology. And they identify pratyaksha, perception, that is, you perceive with your senses and sense organs. Anumana, inference, going from cause to effect, using logical deduction. Upamana, comparison, analogy. Arthapatti, postulation or conjecture. Shabda, which is testimony or evidence or text or someone's report. And anupalabdhi, or non-apprehension. And the six darshanas take one or more of these methods of knowledge as their valid means of gaining knowledge. That's an excellent text, like the Vedanta Paribhasha and Methods of Knowledge by Swami Satprakashananda, that talk about these systems of gaining knowledge in classical Indian culture, and talk about how we can gain architectural knowledge through perception, through inference, by comparison and analogy, by conjecture, by the testimony of other architects, and also by non-apprehension, by what is not there, we can also gain knowledge about architecture. So these pramanas from the various darshanas in the classical culture of India provide us this framework, and we have had this for thousands of years, and we have not accessed this. We have our own educational systems, and we do not know about these well-organized, rigorous methods of gaining knowledge. If you read the Vedanta Paribhasha, you'll see that they were very meticulous about how to prescribe the valid methods of gaining knowledge. How useful would that be in an educational setting where we learn about architecture? Are we using these methods of gaining knowledge? What methods do we use? Or maybe we use some of those, like comparison analogy, we use case studies. Inference, we infer certain things from looking at a building. So those kinds of things are still happening, but not in a structured way. So the other branch of philosophy I talked about, aesthetics. We talk about aesthetics in architecture schools. We talk about balance, rhythm, harmony, proportion, all of these kinds of things. But in Indian culture, classical culture, we have a much more sophisticated system. We have the Navarasa, the nine feelings or emotions. These are psychological. They're not reduced to diagrams. They're not reduced to mathematics. They are direct feelings, direct emotions that you can evoke with your architecture. There's Shringara, love, beauty, Hasya, laughter, Karuna, sorrow, Raudra, anger, Veera, courage, Bhayanaka, terror, fear, Bibhatsa, disgust, Adbhuta, surprise, wonder, Enchanta, peace, or tranquility. Such beautiful emotions, the basic emotions, the Navarasa, the nine basic emotions or feelings. Now we can aspire to create architecture based on these Navarasas rather than some abstract notion which we do not know if it forms the basis for an aesthetic experience. So this is how aesthetics is described in the Vastu Shastra. This is from the Mayamatam, and there are types of temples described in the Mayamatam. And the first one is Shantika, and they give you the proportions to 1:0.7, and that's supposed to be peaceful and tranquil. Then we have Paushtika, which is healthy and strong. They say Pushti, yeah, and 1:1.5. And then there is Jayada, which is victorious, that is 1:1.75. And then Adbhutam, wonderful, 1:2. So they took this system of proportions and they gave these proportions an emotional name, a psychological feeling or something associated with an emotional and psychological response. Which is more exciting, 1:2 or Adbhuta? Which is more exciting, 1:1.75 or Jayada? So you'll have to think about these things. So we had these beautiful systems of describing architecture. Even though they were mathematically based, they were able to correlate the mathematics to the psychology, to the emotion, and the aesthetic response. So taking all these tattvas, the 36 tattvas and the branches of philosophy, and you can start to get at the core of the Vastu Shastra, which is the creation of the Vastu Purusha Mandala. So the Vastu Purusha Mandala is a psychocosmogram. It means it represents all vastus that are created. And it is taking a part of universal consciousness, the Chit or Shiva, and then the Vastu Purusha is the architectural soul that dwells. And the mandala, can split it into man and dala, mind petal. And that is the pattern in the mind that you create when this architectural soul starts to dwell. So when the Vastu Purusha starts to dwell, you create a pattern in your mind, and that is the mandala. So every design that you create in your design studio is a realization of the Vastu Purusha mandala, because you are the Vastu Purusha, the architectural soul that is dreaming of dwelling, and the pattern in the mind is the design that you're creating. So every design you create in studio is a Vastu Purusha mandala, because you as the Vastu Purusha are coming up with the mandala or the pattern in your mind. And then you have the yantras in India where this is the Vastu Purusha mandala, and you can see how it is allocated to the different deities, different parts of the mandala. And the actual Vastu Purusha is shown as having been pinned into this mandala. So you're taking this chit consciousness and you're grabbing this Vastu Purusha from that consciousness, the part of consciousness that dwells, or the architectural soul, and you pin it into a pattern. And that is your architecture, that's your Vastu. So it's like taking a piece of consciousness and pinning it into a pattern, and thereby establishing the Vastu Purusha mandala. So this is a little animation, that's the mandala, and that becomes the shikara of the temple. So that is a direct realization from the mandala to a three-dimensional form. This is the Sri Yantra. This is a pattern of your mind when it works. If you meditate on it, you understand how your mind is working. There are techniques to do it, very elaborate techniques. So you actually have a process by which you can meditate on this and understand how your mind works. This is Western science's version of it. That those are the neural pathways in your brain obtained through MRI and fMRI scans. So that's what the Sri Yantra looks like to the neuroscientist. And they are attempting to get at the same thing, understanding the pattern of how your mind works. Now, if you study architecture and you're able to extract the pattern of the mind that created the architecture, that's a profound understanding. So can you create a yantra that creates a work of architecture? Can you create an architectural yantra? That's what I want you to think about. So when I was in architecture school at the School of Architecture and Planning in Chennai, we were introduced to a book very popular at that time for first year and second year students called Space, Time, and Architecture. Let us see how the culture of India handled space and time and architecture. So this is the measurement of space. It starts with 8 atoms that become a speck of dust, 8 specks of dust that become the egg of a louse or lice. I know ladies pick lice sometimes from their hair. 8 nits make a louse, 8 lice, a grain of barley, 8 grains of barley, 1 angula. 1 angula is cognate with what the West calls an inch. It's about 3/4 of an inch. So if you convert the angula to the atoms in the scale of measurement, you get 32,768 paramanavas, which are your atoms. And then if you take the inch and you convert it into angstroms and you measure it in terms of the wavelengths of light, the wavelength of red light is 36,285 wavelengths in 1 inch. So 36,285 wavelengths in 1 inch, 32,768 paramanavas in one angula. This is how sophisticated the Indian system of measuring space was. It's still consistent with modern science. So the angula then is extended to your span, and the span becomes the cubit, the cubits become the pole becomes the rope. So in Vastu Shastra, there are categories of vastu. There are seats of furniture and vehicles, which is interesting. And then there are buildings, and then there are villages and towns. The seats and vehicles use the digits and the cubits, the angula and the cubit. The buildings use the cubit and the pole. The village and towns use the pole and the rope. So that's the angula in the finger, the middle phalanx of the middle finger, the span, and the cubit. Now, if you look at the body and you look at the junctions of the body, if you measure your body, and you can look at it this way, if you measure your body in spans, everything from joint to joint, from the outstretched tip of your finger to your shoulder, from shoulder to shoulder, from outstretched tip of your finger to your elbow, your hip to your knee to your ankle, everything is in multiples of spans, the vitasti. So our whole body's measurement system, we study anthropometrics in architecture school. The ancient people just had the span, and with the span and the angula, their hands. So all the craftsmen who were working on the buildings, they had their measurement tools, they had their hands, and they could measure the full anthropometric measurements just using the angula and the vitasti. So this is Corbusier. He invented the modular. People are familiar with this in architecture school. And he uses the similar flex points of the body, the hip, the elbow, the shoulder, and all of those things, which the ancient system of India did much better than Le Corbusier. So if you look at Corbusier's system, some of the points that he picks are arbitrary, whereas the Indian system is perfectly aligned with the flex points and the junctions of the human body. Very, very interesting how we have had a system all this while and we have not appreciated it. So the measurement of macro space, this is the kakani or eight poles square. This is the measurement of a plot of land, kakani. I think there's a building called Kakani Towers on Nungambakkam High Road that I knew the client and the architect. It goes on from the kakani to one family plot of four vatikas, which if you interpret the measurement system one way is 16.92 acres. But if you interpret the kakani as eight poles in perimeter of a square, the family plot is 1.058 acres. Now you might think, why is this important? The next slide will point to that. And there's another measurement there called a goruta or gavyuta, which is the sound of a cow. This is an acoustic measurement. The farmers needed to be able to listen to their cows when their cows called out. So the distance the sound of the cow traveled, four kroshas, 2,000 dandas, 12,000 feet. Very, very interesting. They are an acoustic measure of distance in the Indian system, the sound of the cow. And then the yojanas. Yojanas also used as the word for thought. And if you looked at how communication happened in those villages in ancient India, 9.09 miles is about how far you could communicate word of mouth from person to person without your cell phone or anything else that you have now. But nowadays, yojanas can be much longer, much larger. It can span the entire globe. Very, very interesting system that we have. So this is an exercise in Vedic town planning that my students do, and they lay out the village according to those systems of measurement and systems of planning. I make my students at North Dakota State University do this so that they understand a system that's completely different from what they're used to. But the interesting thing is, this is Frank Lloyd Wright's vision for Broad Acre City. He called it Broad Acre City because he wanted to allocate each family 1 acre. And the Indian system, if you interpret the Kakani as 8 poles square, that is perimeter, one family plot is 1.058 acres. Frank Lloyd Wright, Broad Acre City, one family plot, 1 acre. So that's how much we had anticipated Frank Lloyd Wright. And I say we generously because I've become an American citizen now, but India is always where my heart is. So the measurement of time, 1 day is divided into 15 muhurtas. Muhurtam, you may know that already. So one muhurta is about 2 nalikas, one nalika, 48 kalas. So it goes on and on to one nimisha. One nimisha is 0.24 seconds. And if you compare that to the blinking of your eye, because a nimisha is when Shiva closes his eye, and unmesha is when he opens it. So unmesha, nimesha, unmesha, nimesha. Shiva creates the world, Shiva dissolves the world. So this nimesha, give me a nimisham, right? You say in Tamil. So it's 0.24 seconds. And if you take the neuronal speed of neural activity in your body is about 2 meters in length. So you have about 15 full body neuronal responses possible in one nimisha. So you can do 15 micro acts from your brain to different parts of your body in one nimisham or one nimisha. That's when Shiva closes his eyes. So the blinking, and if you compare the scientific measurement of the duration of a blink, it's very close to that time of 0.24 seconds. So this is another slide. So where do we go with all of this? So you have this classical culture, you have this tradition of philosophy, you have this knowledge base, yet you want to work in contemporary practice, you want to engage all these new technologies, you want to be part of the times, you want to be, you know, progressing, all of these things. These are not mutually exclusive. You can take the philosophy of India, its classical culture, its systems of knowledge, and you can create a philosophy for the architecture of India that will enable you to practice even now. This is an exercise my students do in my seminar on the architecture of India. They design the temple according to the Mayamatam and the specifications in the Mayamatam. And then they build a 3D model using computer software. And then they 3D print it. This is a rock-cut temple. So in the traditional process, you take one big block of stone and you carve down and you take away everything that's not the temple and leave the temple. The 3D printer, mm-hmm. you build mm-hmm. it up. You build mm-hmm. up the temple mm-hmm. layer by layer on the 3D printer. So this is an additive process. The ancient way was a subtractive process. So you're able to take an expression, an aesthetic expression, and you're able to realize it using a different means, a different color. That's one of the veils or kanchikas of Maya. One of the colors is 3D printing now. So that color you take, kalai in Tamil, and you take that and you build it. And it doesn't have to leave the philosophical system for you to do that. And this is another exercise my students do. This is a dynamo, part of Revit. And they learn to script and create these components of this temple. They were working on creating the whole temple. So they are programming all these pieces based on the specifications and the Mayamatam, which is a Vastu Shastra. So they take the Vastu Shastra, literally interpret it line by line, and then they create the computer code to create the architectural component. Now, we have this richness we have all of this culture, all of this systematic ways of looking at things, and yet these don't find a way into our architecture schools, which is very, very sad. I'm doing this in Fargo, North Dakota, at North Dakota State University with a bunch of students who are from Minnesota and North Dakota and a few other states nearby. They're totally fascinated by this when they learn about this. And I have some sadness that, you know, students in India, architecture students, don't have a similar access and appreciation for building this philosophy for the architecture of India. So in moving towards closure, I want to talk about one Western philosopher who did talk about dwelling in a significant way and maybe came closest to identifying a philosophy of dwelling and thereby addressing Vastu Shastra. And that was the German philosopher, Martin Heidegger. He focused on being and dwelling. His concept was, we are beings in the world. So there's a thing called world and we are beings in the world. And we are beings with others. It means we have other people that we are with. And we are beings towards death. Death is a finality for all of us, and we are moving towards death from the time we are born. And we exist by gathering the fourfold indwelling. We call this the fourfold: earth, sky, mortals, and gods. So in every act of dwelling, we gather the earth, we gather the sky, we gather mortals, and we gather the gods. This being he called Dasein, which is cognate with the word Vasi, Vasi in India. Vastu is also related to Vasi. And all these words have as the Sanskrit root us from the Dhatupada of Panini, which is the word for to be or to dwell. So if you want to dwell in this classical culture of India, and you want to create architecture that helps people to dwell in this classical culture of India, this is a path that I presented today that would be worth exploring as an insight that you can use to go on this journey. I'm looking forward to a lot of discussion, collaboration, and I'm going to reach out to all of you to invite you to start conversing with me via social media, email, so many other sources now, and start this journey towards creating a philosophy for the architecture of India, because we have a richness that's untapped, and a lot of the work that's being done is, could benefit a great deal from this foundation and this basis. I hope I've done enough to spark an interest for you to make connections and for you to start thinking about how you can take this venerable knowledge, this classical culture, and then you can create a philosophy for the architecture of India. With that, thank you. I enjoyed presenting this to you. I hope we have some time for some questions and discussion. And
thank you, sir, for the enlightening session. We all enjoyed it very much. We shall now move on to the question and answer session, and participants can make use of the chat box for their questions. We do have one question from Tarun, sir. Sir, many people have this doubt even today. Is Vastu based on religious beliefs or scientific reasons? Because in different states in India, there are different versions of Vastu and their beliefs. So how would you fix onto one type while designing a building for your client or yourself?
Okay. The reason why I pointed out that Vastu Purusha Mandala, that is an abstract concept. It is not prescriptive. It is not a system. It is not a way where you match a process with a way of doing things. In the most profound abstract sense, the Vastu Purusha Mandala is a Vastu Purusha, an architectural soul that is creating a pattern in their mind, a mandala. And this Vastu Purusha is realizing the mandala as a Vastu. So the Vastu Purusha Mandala is the ideal. And the Vastu Shastras are technical treatises that tell you how you can realize these different forms of these Vastu Purusha Mandalas. What is not written in the ancient texts is how Vastu Purusha Mandalas are created in contemporary practice, what they should look like, and how they should perform. That is what I'm trying to suggest we need to work towards, which is a philosophy for the architecture of India, where we create Vastu Purusha Mandalas still as a method, but these Vastu Purusha Mandalas are completely different from what we see in the ancient texts and treatises. So if you are an architectural soul and you dwell and you create a pattern in your mind for that dwelling, you have created a Vastu Purusha Mandala, and you have to develop the Shastra or the philosophy for how to do it. And that's what we are not attempting to do. We are trying to use the treatises, the ancient treatises, as something prescriptive, as a rule book or something to follow, rather than understanding what it is in the abstract and what it is the ancients were trying to do and whether we can do the same thing in our own context. It's not imitating the ancients, but doing what they did in the same way in your own context. So you're repeating what the ancients did, but in your own way.
Thank you so much, sir. Due to the time constraint, the remaining questions will be sent to the speaker and the answers for the same will be posted on our social media platforms. I hereby extend my sincere gratitude to Dr. Ganapathy Mahalingam, sir, for accepting our invitation to be a part of Hashtag 2021. Thank you so much for your time, sir.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Finally, I request our HOD SRMC, Professor Ashok Kumar, sir, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Yeah, good morning. Good morning, one and all present here. And good evening to you, sir, Dr. Ganapathy, sir.
Yes, it's almost midnight.
Midnight, yeah. Sorry for that. And on behalf of School of Environment, Architecture and Design, SRM University, Ramapuram campus, one and all present here. Thank you very much. And of course, our guest speaker for today, it's great hearing to you, sir, Dr. Ganapathy Mahalingam, sir. As you are spending your time in the late evening in US, thank you very much for your gesture and time, sir. It's a grace listening to you, hearing on that topic, philosophy of architecture of India or architecture in India, from the prehistoric period and to nowadays time. So we thank you for your expert talk on Vastu and Tattvas, about the history and philosophy of architecture and, of course, preserving these heritages. But culturally, religiously, many Tattvas, Vedas, Mandalas, and as you were describing about the measurements in Vastu and things like that. The region, our India, as you were telling, the describing about Indian heritage, the region have rich scientific interpretation and implication in all its heritage and built forms. And of course, the Vastu planning procedures used in evolution of forms in temples and mandapas are great. Still, many are researching on that, and of course, we are it's a great knowledge our ancestors had those times. And even now, in contemporary period, the renowned architects all also using these concepts, as you are mentioning in your speech and lecture today. And great hearing to you, sir, today on this knowledge you are sharing with us. Your experience is awesome and your expertise in this topic. Thank you very much, sir.
And thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Pleasure is all mine.
Thank you very much, sir. And on behalf of SRM management and chairpersons, directors, deans, our VP admin giving us the support and encouragement to conduct this online webinar, Hashtag 2021. Thank you very much. For their support. On behalf of them, I once again extend our thanks to you, sir. And our special thanks to Madan's Makeover for their contributions and giving a special prizes to our winning students, participants, etc. We thank our coordinators, our student coordinator, especially today's moderator, Roslet, and our faculty coordinator, Professor NSR Ravi, our design chair, who is the main key role in bringing you to us and deliver this lecture today. Thank you very much, sir. And all our faculty members and student office bearers, students team, technical team, design graphics team, one and all who are all directly and indirectly supporting this webinar. Thank you very much. We thank all our participants. Once again, our architects, friends, parents, students in other colleges, for your continuous support and the hearing to us in this Hashtag 2021. It's a global event as during this pandemic. Thank you one and all present here. Nandri, vanakkam, sir.
Thank you, sir. I once again thank all the participants who have joined today. And also we invite you for our next webinar, which is at 10 a.m. today on the topic, A Journey in Architecture, which will be delivered by Architecture Jata Shankar. We welcome you all and expect to see you there for the next session too. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Recording stopped.